the Mount Olive AME Zion Church, where we are advancing the kingdom of God by making disciples. Thank you for joining us. We pray that you will be encouraged by the word that is shared on today. At the end of the message, we will provide you more information on how to connect with our church. Be blessed.
Welcome to Mount Olive AME Zion Church here in Waterbury, Connecticut. Thank you for taking out the time to join with us for worship and word. My name is Kelsey Hopson, and I am the pastor of this wonderful community of faith. Again, we are excited that you are here with us, and we are excited about the word that God has for us on today. We are in a two-part sermon series, and this is the second installment called A Chance to Be Better. A Chance to Be Better. We're going to take a look at Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and verse 10. Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and verse 10. And so if you would, take a look at your Bible or your devices, and let's go to the Word of God. And it reads from the New Living Translation, "Then the Lord spoke to Jonah a second time. Get up and go to the great city of Nineveh and deliver the message I have given you." This time, Jonah obeyed the Lord's command and went to Nineveh, a city so large that it took 3 days to see it all. On the day Jonah entered the city, he shouted to the crowds, 40 days from now, Nineveh will be destroyed." The people of Nineveh believed God's message, and from the greatest to the least, they declared a fast and put on burlap to show their sorrow. Verse 10, "When God saw what they had done and how they had put a stop to their evil ways, he changed his mind and did not carry out the destruction he had threatened." Yeah. Let's pray. Lord God, we love you. We give you thanks, oh God, for who you are, for all that you've done, doing, and even in advance for what you are going to do. We ask, oh God, that you would send your word. Lord God, we thank you for the anointing that makes preaching possible, that makes preaching practical, that makes preaching powerful. You know what it is that we stand in need of. Meet us where we are, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your saving grace. We thank you for your sustaining grace, Lord God. Have your way. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. And everyone right where you are, say amen. Amen. Put your hands together in advance, giving God a hand of praise for what God is about to do. Amen. Right where you are, right where you are. Give God a hand of praise right where you are. Amen. 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 Indeed, we ought to be grateful and thankful for each day, each opportunity that God gives us. Amen. To hear the word of God and be transformed by the same. A chance to be better. A chance to be better. Beloved, each day is a gift from God. Each day is a day that we've never seen and that we will never see again. So it makes sense that we would make the most of each day and the opportunities that we have. And because we are imperfect people in an imperfect world, there are some days, there are some weeks, there are some seasons that when we reflect upon, when we look back, we realize that we could have done better. We realize that we could have been better. The senior saints would pray, and sometimes I pray this prayer, "Lord, thank you for another day to get it right." Each day, it is another day to get it right. Each day is another day to be better. Lamentations 3:22 verses through 23 says, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. Why? For his compassions or his mercies never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And here in this text in the book of Jonah, the prophet Jonah, he has a chance not only to do better, but I believe that he is given a chance to be better, a chance to be better. God has this proclivity for appearing and reappearing, for showing up in our lives. Hallelujah. Which in and of itself, God showing up, it is a grace. It's a grace. In fact, we know that from the text that the Lord spoke to Jonah a second time, telling him to get up and to go to the great city of Nineveh to deliver a message. The message that God had given him. God's grace, this showing up, God's grace, it's undeserved. Yet it requires responsibility on the part of the recipient. In our response to God's undeserved favor, God's mercies in our lives, it must be responsible. Because although grace is free, it's undeserved, it's not cheap, and we can't be irresponsible to the grace that God extends. And so here it is in verse 1. We learn that this is the second time that the Lord has spoken to Jonah. You see, because the first time that the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, in the book of Jonah chapter 1 with an assignment, Jonah's response, it was to run away from the Lord and get as far away as he could. He ran from the Lord and his God-given assignment. It took a life-threatening storm. It took a ship crew to throw him overboard. It took God to send a big fish to swallow him and to hold him 3 days and three nights in the belly of the big fish in order for Jonah to then seek the Lord in prayer while he is in distress and he's not in a position to bargain. And finally, he declares in chapter 2, verse 9, that with a song of thanksgiving, I will sacrifice to you what I have vowed, I will make good. Salvation comes from the Lord. He comes to his senses in a real sense. And so, which brings us to verse 3 of our text, where the scripture says that Jonah, he obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. And so this sounds good. This is the designation, thus the designation of the reluctant prophet at best is given to Jonah. This rebellious prophet hasn't always been a reluctant servant for the Lord. In fact, it was this Jonah, this prophet, who predicted the remarkable expansion of Israel's territory during the reign of Jeroboam the second. Jeroboam II, he reigned over Israel for 41 years. He was the 14th king of Israel, and he was the fourth in the line of the dynasty of Jehu. And this king, Jeroboam II, he was successful in his military adventures. In fact, he actually regained most of the territory that had belonged to Israel during the time of David and Solomon. And so what in the world happened to Jonah? What is Jonah's problem that Jonah is reluctant at best and rebellious in his behavior and maybe even in his heart? Let's go a little deeper. Nineveh is a great city. It would eventually become the capital of the vast Assyrian Empire. And the Assyrians, they were Israel's most dreaded enemy. And in fact, they even flaunted their power. And here the Lord doesn't point out the particular sin of the city Nineveh here in the book of Jonah. But the prophet Nahum says and goes on record of Nineveh's guilt of idolatry, prostitution, witchcraft, evil plots against God, exploitation of the helpless, and even cruelty in war. And so Jonah, he grew up hating the Assyrians and fearing them. In fact, Jonah's attitude, it is representative of the nation of Israel in their reluctance to share the love and mercy of God with other people, with other nations. And Jonah, just as the nation did, Jonah struggled with nationalism and exclusivism. Jonah and the nation of Israel struggled with nationalism and exclusivism. In other words, they did not understand God's universal love. Jonah had an issue. In fact, Jonah, he was full of pride and prejudice. Jonah was full of pride and prejudice. Jonah, here it is. Jonah is hard-hearted and hypocritical. Okay, let's check out the king of Israel. The leadership and the nation. Scripture testifies that Jeroboam in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 24, that he did evil in the sight of the Lord. Hosea, the prophets, Hosea, Amos, and Jonah, they lived during the reign of Jeroboam the second. And the biblical historian offers a negative evaluation that is consistent with many of the kings of Israel, namely that he followed in the apostasy of Jeroboam the first. And then the prophet Amos, he threatened that Yahweh would rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. And then the priest Amaziah prophesied Jeroboam's demise. And it is during this time of superficial prosperity that the prophet Amos especially spoke against many, watch this, social abuses in Israel, that justice was in the hands of lawless judges. The dishonest merchants falsified balances by deceit, and that worship was a little more than a pious smokescreen that covered the terrible abuses of the poor. Have mercy, somebody. It is this Jonah, what's your problem? You have an opportunity to be better. It is this Jonah from this nation, Israel, who is the reluctant prophet that God sends to Nineveh for a second time, giving him another chance to be obedient, giving him a chance to do better, giving him a chance to be better on mission with God and for God. God shows up, God appears in unlikely places to unlikely people, and God uses them for God's divine purposes. God uses folk who don't want to be used to save and to show mercy and to show God's compassion. And although Jonah and the nation of Israel, they were self-centered, selfish, exclusive, and they lacked compassion toward those they didn't like, those that they looked down upon. However, God, he remains faithful. God remains faithful to show up. God remains faithful to show mercy. God remains faithful to extend God's universal love to persons, to groups of people, to cities, and to nations that you may may not care for, to people, to groups of people, to cities, to nations that you may even hate, to folk that you are prejudiced against, to folk that you just look down upon. Jonah had an issue of pride and prejudice. And so the Bible says that that this time Jonah obeyed the commands and he went to Nineveh. And the city is so large that, watch this, it took 3 days. And so I suggest to you that Jonah here, he's obedient, but it's a half-hearted obedience at best. It took 3 days to tour the city of Nineveh. But Jonah only took 1 day to carry out his assignment, his God-given assignment. And so here it is, Jonah, he doesn't care for the people of Nineveh. He doesn't think that they deserve the mercy and the love of God, the ways in which he and his nation does. However, he is in a situation and he doesn't have a choice. And so now he says the right thing and he even does the right thing. But I suggest that it is half-hearted, because while it took 3 days to tour the city, it took Joseph seemingly 1 day to carry out his assignment. His message was 40 days more and Nineveh will be overturned. God, in God's sovereignty, God still used this half-hearted obedience and this message that didn't even include any mention of God, this message that didn't even include a call to repentance. And God nonetheless uses this message to turn the heart. God used this message to change the wicked ways of the people, while the prophet sent with the assignment and the nation of Israel remained the same. Have mercy, somebody. And so I want to make just a couple of points. Watch this right here, is that God, the assignment of God upon your life, it remains the same. You're saying, Lord, what is it that you are calling me to do? God said, I'm calling you to do the first thing that I called you to do, and you refused to do. You abandoned it. You ran from it. God said, I'm calling you to that assignment. And there are nations, there are people, and God has an assignment upon your life. And God says, you know what? Right here, I'm going to hold you in the fish. You're going to experience storms in your life until you do the assignment that I have called you to do. And there are nations that God have called out, that God have sent out. And God says, I know that you have your issues, but there's still an assignment that God has given to you. And so here's what we have to do. We have to accept our assignment. We have to accept our assignment. You got to accept the assignment. Because God can make the most even out of meager. Hallelujah. Oh, God will take what you give him, even if it is half-hearted. God can take what we give him, even if it is half-hearted. Hallelujah. And God can bring about God's purposes. And so what we see here, as we learn, as we look at the response of Nineveh, is that Nineveh, scripture lets us know, watch this, that they did the heart work. That there was some heart work involved. Yes, God turns the heart, but there is some heart work that need to be done. And what this means is this is number two here. Not only do we accept the assignment, but we commit to do the heart work of repentance. We commit to do the heart work of repentance, because as God, when God turns our heart, we can resist and we can rebel, and we have a resistant heart, a rebellious heart. Hallelujah. And so we see, as we look at the response of the Ninevites, led by the leader, they committed to do the heart work of repentance, because the Bible says that they fasted and they prayed. They fasted and they prayed. They had a change of heart. They had an attitude change. And so, beloved, we can be better. We can be better as individuals, as a people group, and as a nation, when we accept our divine assignment and we commit to do the heart work of repentance. Lastly, not only that, we need to do the hard work. The hard work. Commit to do the hard work of changing our ways. Commit to do not only the heart work of repentance, but commit to do the hard work of changing our ways. In other words, you know, the text indicates that you give up evil ways and violence. We have a chance to be better. Do the hard work of changing our ways. And this is what we see, because Jesus indicates that the Ninevites in verse 10 says God saw what they had done and how they had put a stop to their evil ways. In fact, the New Revised Standard Version says they turned from their evil ways, and then God changed God's mind. God relented, God repented, and the destruction that they deserved, scripture says that God relented and God showed mercy. Can I close? Matthew chapter 16, verse 4, Jesus asserted of himself, saying, and see, something greater than Jonah is here. You see, because although the Ninevites, upon hearing Jonah's message, scripture says that they believed God and they fasted and prayed and they changed their wicked ways. However, here is the prophets of God have been preaching to the people of God. And now Jesus, who is greater, is here. And nonetheless, scripture says that Ninevites, that they would be able to testify against that generation because they repented, but the people of God did not. The nation that is supposed to be under God did not repent, did not change their ways. And as Jonah was in the belly of the sea monster 3 days and three nights, the Son of Man, Jesus, was 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And on that God-appointed early Sunday morning, the tomb could no longer hold him, but was forced to release the resurrected Jesus, the Son of God, who ascended into heaven and sent God the Holy Spirit to dwell with and within believers, within the church, oh, the body of Christ in the earth. I said something. There is something greater than Jonah here, and it is the body of Christ. It is the witness of believers. It is the true church of the living God, that God has given prophetic witness to this generation. Oh, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify. We are called to serve this present age. Oh, God has given prophetic witness to give to this generation and to this nation, that you have a chance not only to do better, but we have a chance to be better. A chance for the Jonas to stop avoiding or abandoning your divine assignment, but to accept your assignment. A time for this nation to stop avoiding and abandoning our assignment, but to accept the assignment. We have an opportunity to commit to do the heart work required, the heart work of repentance, fasting and praying, whereby there is a change of attitude, a change of heart. And we must commit to do not only the heart work, but the hard work of change, giving up evil ways and actions, giving up violence. We have a chance to be better, a chance to be better. For God's love is universal. God's love is extended to all. It's important, beloved, that we not think more highly of ourselves than we ought. and be full of pride and prejudice, that we take advantage of each and every day that we have. For each and every day, it is a chance to get it right. It is a chance to be right. It is a chance to submit, to surrender to the ongoing transformation of God within our hearts and even our habits, our actions. Let's be better. Let's be better. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear God, we thank you for each and every day. It is an opportunity that we have. It is a new mercy. And we give you thanks for the new mercy, Lord God. Lord God, and so anyone that is under the sound of my voice, oh God, that desires your great salvation, Lord God, to receive your love. Lord God, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would speak, Lord God, that you would draw them, Lord God, that they might respond to your grace responsibly, Lord God, and receive the gift of salvation, to receive your love, to turn from self and sin and to turn to you and your great salvation, Lord God, for this is a chance to be better. Lord God, and likewise, those individuals who do know you and the pardoning of sin and your great salvation, Lord God, who are in covenant relationship with you, Lord God. Dear Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. We come against the spirit of pride. We come against the spirit of prejudice. We come against the spirit of racism. We come against the spirit of nationalism. We come against the spirit of exclusivism, Lord God. Lord God, and we thank you, Lord God, for inclusivity, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for your love that is universal, that is extended to all people, Lord God, individuals, to all people groups, Lord God, to all nations, Lord God. Lord, we pray that the mercy that has been extended to us, Lord God, that we would extend that mercy to others, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, for each and every day, for each new mercy, Lord God. Lord, may we take advantage of it, Lord God, for it is an opportunity. It is a chance, oh God, to be better. And by your grace, Lord God, we choose to be better. These are the blessings we ask and give thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, beloved. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for joining with us. If you have more questions relative to God's great salvation, or you desire to be a member of this community of faith called Mount Olive AME Zion Church here in Waterbury, Connecticut, we encourage you, we ask you that you would please contact us by way of our email, by way of phone call. Take a look at our website, our Facebook page, and we will be honored to minister to you. Amen. Likewise, if you appreciate this ministry, feel free to give by way of a donation. You can do that by mailing your donation or by way of our website through Givelify. Likewise, if you like what we are doing, please take the time out to subscribe to our YouTube channel and to hit the like button. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. Look forward to seeing you on next week. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining us today. You can connect in the following ways. Our Sunday morning worship at 11 a.m. via Facebook at Mount Olive, Waterbury, Connecticut, or our YouTube channel, Mount Olive AME Zion Church, or our website, MountOliveAMEZ.org. Or you can simply use the dial-in number, 339-207-6251. We also invite you to be a part of our midweek Bible study on Wednesdays at 12 p.m. and 6 p.m. You can connect with us via Zoom. The connection can be found on our Facebook page, or you can dial in at the same number, 339-207-6251. We have prayer at 11:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. You can call in using the dial-in number. Check our Facebook page for information and links. We also encourage you to invite a friend. If you desire to make a donation, simply go to our website, or you can download the Givelify app and search for Mount Olive AME Zion Church. Again, thank you for tuning in. Hope we connect again.